Nowadays, air travel has become so popular, it is hard to decide which is the most important airport in the world. Sure, some are more useful, efficient, safe, and luxurious than others, but that doesn't make them necessarily more important. This couldn't be said almost a decade ago when commercial aviation was at its beginning. Now let's talk about Newfoundland, an island off the east coast of Canada. The interior of Newfoundland is a combination of forests, lakes, and rivers spread across a rocky terrain, where the chances are that you're probably going to see a moose dancing on an iceberg before you see a human. But if it weren't for this island here, transcontinental aviation between Europe and North America would have probably been a real challenge until the early 1960s. So, what made this island so important? Firstly, its position played a crucial role in transatlantic aviation. Newfoundland is as far east as you can go and still be in Canada. It is so far east, in fact, that it has its own time zone, half an hour later than Labrador, although they are considered one province. So far east that it's closer to Ireland than any of these US states beyond this line. Now, let's go back a decade into time. On June 14th, 1919, two British aviators took off from a field in Newfoundland and arrived 16 hours later on the west coast of Ireland. This was the first crossing of the Atlantic Ocean in less than 72 hours. It made sense that if you were worried about crossing the Atlantic and not running out of fuel, the best option was to start in Newfoundland. The British government, who controlled the island back then, realized that air travel between the two continents was possible. So, in 1936, they chose a patch of woods in the northeastern part of Newfoundland, and on the 31st of October, 1939, they opened the Gander Airport, which at the time was the biggest airport in the world. Despite this, its massive runways remained unused, because there just weren't that many planes that could make it across the Atlantic with passengers and cargo. By that time, only a few planes made it over the ocean, and 40 people died trying, so it was a pretty risky job. But then, a certain man invaded a certain country and World War II began. The Allied forces wanted as many fighter planes as they could get. Canada and the United States had been shipping planes by boat, but that took a very long time and it was inefficient because a lot of ships were destroyed by German submarines. So in 1940, they started flying planes from Gander Airport to the UK. In November of that same year, 7 planes were brought to the United Kingdom, and during the war, more than 20,000 followed. Winston Churchill himself referred to Gander as the largest aircraft carrier in the North Atlantic. Gander made history, although in the 1940s, there was no town of Gander. It was just the airport, and the workers who lived near the railways. After the end of the war, there was a boom in commercial air travel, and a separate town was built near the airport. You see, if a plane wanted to get from London to New York, it had to stop in Gander to refuel. So, almost every flight that crossed the Atlantic went through here. This is how Gander got its nickname, the Crossroads of the World. However, because it served as a military airport during the war, it had an old World War II hangar where the planes refueled. And for a lot of passengers, it was their first time in Canada. So the government decided that an old rusty hangar wouldn't leave such a good first impression of the country. With this being said, they built something spectacular. An international lounge with Italian furniture and beautiful sculptures which cost $3 million. This, unfortunately, marked the end of Gander Airport. But fortunately, it marked the beginning of the Gander International Airport. And to celebrate the opening of this international lounge, the lady herself, the legendary mayor of a small town from Quebec, came to Gander. Oh, and I almost forgot, the Queen of England and her husband were also there. Until the 1960s, 400 planes and about 11,000 passengers stopped there daily. These were the glory days of Gander. Celebrities from all over the world went through this airport when leaving or entering the United States. Marilyn Monroe, she was in Gander. The King of Saudi Arabia and Frank Sinatra, they passed through Gander. The first North American city the Beatles have ever stepped in was Gander. Fidel Castro taking dinner with some workers at the airport, then going for a tour of the city with the same guys and then sledding on a snowy street. That also happened in Gander. Gander was really connecting North America and Europe, and was a hotspot, being the most famous and important airport at the time. It stayed this way until the end of the 1960s, when the jet engine was invented and popularized. Jet airlines were able to fly much higher, faster, and farther than older piston-powered planes, making transcontinental travel considerably faster and easier. Suddenly, refueling wasn't necessary, and air routes bypassed Gander and headed straight for the US. So Gander started seeing a downward trend in popularity and importance. However, it still had one very crucial role. You see, planes from Eastern Europe weren't allowed to enter the American airspace. So aircraft that wanted to go from the east of Europe to Cuba stopped in Gander to refuel. it became the most important stopping point between Moscow and Havana. This, however, made many people coming from communist countries try to seek asylum in Canada to escape communism. Some didn't succeed, but others did. Thus, Gander, in his day, was a multicultural city. Canadians, French, Brits, Russians, Cubans lived there all together. But slowly, with the fall of communist countries around Europe and planes just getting better and better, Gander International Airport became quiet for the first time in the 20th century. It seemed like it would remain that way, as it really didn't have a use anymore, until September 11th, 2001, when the single deadliest terror attack in the world happened. Following the attacks, the American government decided to shut down the American airspace, so all flights midair were directed to Canada, 38 of which landed in Gander. 7,000 people, with nothing but the clothes on their backs, were now stranded in this small town in Newfoundland. The residents of the city took the stranded passengers, or the plane people, into their homes and gave them food and a place to sleep. This was dangerous, and they were advised by the authorities not to accommodate anyone because no one knew how widely spread this terrorist attack could be. But Gander was there to help, and some strong bonds formed between the people. At least one marriage is reported to have resulted from this. Nowadays, Gander is quiet. It still has some international traffic, but it's mostly used for military planes, emergency landings, and for private airlines. The International Lounge, built in 1959, still remains unchanged. It is a time capsule going back to an era that is long gone, when Gander was in the spotlight and when Fidel Castro was sledding down the town's snowy streets.